Good morning and welcome to the... That's loud. Thank you. Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2023. Our first item on our agenda this morning is our final evidence session on the Disabled Children and Young People Transitions to Adult Scotland Bill. And can I welcome our first panel of witnesses back to the committee. Thank you. Pam Duncan Clancy, MSP, member in charge of the bill, and Bill Scott, senior policy advisor for Inclusion Scotland. We're going to begin with a short statement from Pam Duncan Clancy before moving to questions from members. You have 3 minutes, Pam. Thank you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the committee. It's a pleasure to be back here in front of you today. And thank you. I want to thank you for all the evidence that you've taken on this bill. It's an incredibly important bill, as I'm sure you'll all agree. So the evidence you've taken and the people that this matters to will be hugely appreciative of the work that you've done. I also would like to put on record my thanks to Joanne Lamont for bringing this bill in session five. And I want to say thank you to all the work that she did on that bill and that allowed me to bring this bill back. Back in session five, Joanne identified what my own transition has taught me, which is, of course, that there is a problem and that thousands of young people a year are being failed. We know that disabled people are three times more likely to not be in education, employment or training, and that this hasn't changed, incidentally, since 2008. And there's a briefing that was prepared by Inclusion Scotland in 2008 that I have with me today that says that those figures have not changed since then. There's a five-point gap in the number of disabled people getting grades A to C at hires. Disabled people's economic activity rate is three times higher than the inactivity rate for non-disabled people. They're half as likely to be employed, and that's worse in certain groups like people with learning disability. And perhaps the hardest thing to hear is that at 16, young disabled people have the same aspirations as everyone else, but by the age of 26, they believe nothing they can do will change their lives. At a time when they should be excited about their future, thinking about what they want to be and who they want to be, we're stripping them of hope. Convener, at this point in their life, it's hardly any wonder that they feel like project managers. They're not focused on their dreams or ambitions, but they're project managing their own life and the future that it brings. That is not something that we can continue with. And I remember my own transitions when we finally got a plan in place, when my mum said to me, "I can now be your mum again." And that's never really left me. And I think that's one of the reasons why we have to take this forward. Convener, this is not a new issue, as I said a moment ago. Inclusion Scotland said in a briefing in 2008 that if the correct support is not delivered during this crucial phase, it is likely that disabled people will not enter college to obtain qualifications crucial to prospective employers. If this occurs, they'll end up NEET and they'll remain in limbo. It becomes increasingly difficult to escape it. They were right in 2008 and they remain right now. We know that progress has been too slow and we can't leave this to chance. If we're serious about the rights of young disabled people, their move to adulthood can't be left by chance. This is a matter of equality, human rights and justice. It also shouldn't rest on a manifesto commitment and good faith acting by ministers. And we've seen what can happen when they come and go. So when this bill first came, the first time round, it was noted in committee that the SNP manifesto committed to a national transition strategy. And then at that point, it had been 5 years since that commitment and there was no strategy. We also know that things like the deposit return scheme looks like it could be deprioritised depending on leadership. And I don't say this to be provocative, convener. I say this to highlight the transient nature of strategies that are plans and not laws. There is much action already existing. I recognise that. And I'm sure we'll cover a lot of that today. But we really need a bill to address it. And you might ask, why my bill? To that, I say this. It doesn't undo current work, it adds to it. It creates a legislative structure for the one child, one plan approach that the additional support for learning review and the coordinate support plan review recommend. It requires a transition strategy in law and laid before Parliament, protecting it against the change of government or leadership. It provides an opportunity for scrutiny that the additional ASL 2004 Act does not. And it addresses issues in the Morgan Review that says the implementation of additional support for learning legislation is over-dependent on committed individuals, fragmented and inconsistent, and is not ensuring that all children and young people who need additional support are being supported to flourish and meet their potential. My bill seeks to make that, and they also said, sorry, that it is always someone else's problem. Well, my bill seeks to address that. And a lot of people agree with me as well, and we'll come to talk about that later, but the Law Society, the Children's Commissioner, Enable Scotland, National Autistic Society, a number of organisations believe that this bill in front of you is the bill that will make the change that we really need to see. And you might also ask, why not wait to see if the current strategy works? And I'll draw to a close with this. We've heard this before. I'll be 42 this year. I graduated in 2004, 2 years after I should have, because my transition wasn't planned properly. Despite that, blood, sweat and tears, I got there in the end. And I think we can all agree that if it takes the tenacity of a future parliamentarian, one good worker, and I know we've all heard of the worker from Falkirk who did some great work, and a fighter mum to get there, something needs to change.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Pam. Can we move to questions now, starting with Ruth Maguire? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thanks for being with us, and I appreciate your opening statement, in particular your recognition of the evidence that committee colleagues have taken. We're also very grateful to the young people, parents and practitioners that shared their expert experience with us. I'd like to ask you about the implementation gap, because I know we've recognised there that there are policies in place. So we've heard from parents, young people and practitioners that the reason for that gap is about capacity, is about resources. Parents talked to us about communication as well, and practitioners in particular spoke about culture and leadership. So can I ask what your view is about, you know, why we have this implementation gap? Because it is clear that what we have in place at the moment is failing too many of our disabled children and young people. So what's your view of the reasons for that implementation gap that young people are experiencing?
Thank you to Ruth Maguire for that question. There are a number of reasons for that implementation gap, and you've highlighted some of them. And of course, they do include culture, they include education and support, training, awareness raising, and they include resources. But crucially, policy is driven by legislation. And I believe the current policy and legislative framework is not driving the change that we need. And I'd just like to take a moment to talk through the current structures and why I don't think they fit what we need right now. So, for example, the Scottish Government's own literature review that was published this week recognised that there have been significant failures across guidance and indeed in implementation. The Fraser of Allender Institute reflected that transitions do not need to be difficult if they're well planned and well managed. However, the evidence suggests that it's rarely the case. The Royal College of OTs told this committee that everyone feels that they're working in crisis mode at the moment, which means that transitions and long-term planning are taking a step back. And that actually highlights, I think, one of the serious concerns about implementation. When the going gets tough, it's always disabled people who end up to have to get going. So we've seen it through various different economic crises and various different crisis, including the COVID pandemic and, of course, the current cost of living crisis. So we know that the implementation gap does exist, but we also know that when it isn't a statutory duty to provide something for disabled people, it isn't provided. And that's the stark reality of society that we're in. We really do need the legislation to drive that policy. The Law Society agree. They've said that a national transition strategy would contribute to achieving all of the rights accorded by the UNCRPD by ensuring that all relevant policies and planning, as well as individual planning, achieves that purpose. And they go on to say, we would suggest that significant improvement is unlikely to be achieved without legislative measures.
Okay, thank you for that.
Can I maybe, I think Bill was going to...
I'll just maybe ask you a question, if that's okay, and then maybe Bill could come in after that. So, I mean, we do have legislation in place. I mean, as we would all acknowledge, that clearly there is an implementation gap. What is it about additional legislation in the form of this bill that addresses those things? I think we're probably in agreement about what the sort of themes of the reason for the gap are. So, you know, we agreed there on resources and capacity. So what about your legislation will address that, for example?
So the first thing I'd say is that much of this rests just now in the legislative structure created by the ASL Act in 2004. And that Act provides that there is the availability of a coordinated support plan. Now, we know that very, very few people get a coordinated support plan, but we also know that those transitions plans, which would be covered by that and legislation, are quite limited in nature, given the purpose of the coordinated support plan, the only focus on education, and also they're not deliberately targeted at disabled people who this bill is intended to support. So we recognise that there is a significant underrepresentation of disabled people in employment and going on to positive destinations, and this bill seeks to address that group of people and support them. The statutory guidance locates the planning process within the ASL Act within a child's plan, but that the part of the legislation that brings a child's plan was repealed in 2019, so that again leaves a huge gap in provision. The duties in the ASL Act cover all pupils with additional support needs, but that is limited by the words sees fit if any, and the local authority may not see it fit to exchange information or indeed to put in place a plan for a young disabled person. It's also a different group of people that we're looking to support here with this particular piece of legislation. We're looking to address the significant discrimination and oppression faced by a group of people who have a protected characteristic and are disabled people under the Equality Act. And the duties and regulations in the current ASL Act as well are caveated and apply only in relation to such children and young persons as the authority consider appropriate. The review of coordinated support plans, which is part of the ASL Act, also considered that there's a need for clarity on the relationship between those plans, child plans and other plans. And in fact, it suggested a one child, one plan approach. I would contend that this bill delivers that. Please.
Yeah, very much so. I think there's a really reasonable question being asked, which is why will this make a difference? The problem at the moment is coordinated support plans should be given to just about every disabled child that's identified, because they've all got multiple support needs. There's 1,780 school leavers, according to the latest figures released yesterday, left school last year. 1,780 were disabled children and young people. Of those, if we're lucky, between 1 and 2% of them received a coordinated support plan, which is, 30-odd? One per local authority? That is a huge, huge failure. And if resources are the issue, and every local authority at the moment is telling us that their finances are hard-pressed, what is the chance that guidance, and guidance is always voluntary, you're not required to follow it, you're just told it's best practice if you do that. What is the chance that resources, which local authorities say they haven't got at the moment, are going to go towards giving every disabled child the support that they need before they leave school and afterwards? Because again, the Fraser Islander findings were that support had to be in place until young people were 25. That's because some of them leave school with what looks like a positive destination to go to college, and 2 years later are no further on in their journey in life, no better qualifications than when they left school, etc. So this bill at least says resources are needed to do this. Now, we might have got our figures wrong in terms of the amount of money that's required, but what we're talking about is somewhere between 10 and 15 million. Is that investment in the future of tens of thousands of disabled school leavers worthwhile? I would argue very definitely that it is. But if we want it to happen, we have to give the dedicated resources to local authorities to do it. And this bill creates, every child gets a plan, every child is entitled to support. They might not always opt to get that support, but every child is entitled to support until they reach 25. And the Scottish Government's own review of the literature and the research conducted with young people and their parents said early and sustained transition planning is essential. Holistic, coordinated wraparound support, services delivered in partnership, a designated key worker, which is what this legislation does, and person-centred, family involvement in the preparation of the plan, etc. It's all there in the bill. You know, it just needs to be translated into practice. And that, to do that, you need the resources.
Very briefly from Ruth.
Just to say that I think there's a lot to probe in that, but I don't want to tread on other people's questioning.
And there's some of the substance of your response there, Bill Scott, will be interrogated, when I'll use that, it's the wrong word, I'm struggling, later on by my vice convener. But I'm going to move to questions firstly from Graham Day to follow on.
Thanks, Camille. I've got a couple of questions. Good morning. The Scottish Transitions Forum talked last week about a legislation salad. And there is a view that's been expressed that the landscape is already very congested as it is. I'm interested to explore with you how easily you think the proposals in the bill would dovetail with existing duties and avoid a situation, and also the current policy development, like the principles and practice trials, so that you would avoid a situation where, regrettably perhaps, that congestion would simply provide cover for more inaction rather than enable what we're all wanting to see here, which is an improvement in the situation. So that's my first question.
Thank you very much for that, Graham Day. And I heard the evidence that you took that referred to the legislation salad. I actually thought it was a really good description of where it is. And it is a bit of a legislation salad. I can't disagree with that, actually. There are a number of bits and pieces of legislation that are relevant here, but none of them are delivering the change that we really need to see. We're still in a situation where young disabled people are less likely to be in employment, where they're more likely to be not in education or training. So the current legislation salad, or the current salad, is not what we need. We need a bit of a different menu, if I'm honest. And the reasons that I would say that are because of some of the points I made earlier on about the ASL Act. But the Morgan Review itself also recognised this, where it said that the adult support for learning legislation is over-dependent on committed individuals. That, I think, speaks a bit to Ruth Maguire's earlier question about the implementation gap. Is fragmented and inconsistent and is not ensuring that all young children and young people who need additional support are being supported to flourish and fulfil their potential. And of course, I said earlier as well that the Law Society recognised that too. Now, there is nothing in this particular legislation that says the principles into practice should no longer exist or not, or wouldn't continue. In fact, I would suggest, and I think the work that's been done on the principles into practice and the work that the Transitions Forum is excellent. And actually, that could dovetail really nicely with some of the powers in this legislation for guidance and support, because as with any piece of legislation, people will need support, they'll need advice, they'll need guidance. We need principles on which to support it. And also, I would say, if we want to put principles into practice, we might also consider putting some of them into legislation, so that that then drives the practice that we need to see. There's various different bits and pieces. So some of that salad might include, for example, the self-directed support legislation. The self-directed support legislation itself, the independent review of that, said that it needs scaled up, but it's also separate to this particular bill. If I thought I could bring one bill that would solve every single problem disabled people face in Scotland, starting from when they were born until they die, I would do it. But actually, there are a number of different bits of legislation that are intended to have an impact on disabled people's lives. But what we don't have is something that is supporting them through a crucial part in their life from about the age of 14, which the bill suggests, up until the age of 26, as Bill set out early on, that helps people pull together all of that bits of legislation salad that gives them rights and support at different parts of their life, that pulls that together and becomes a coordinating framework for that management. Because just now, too many families are distressed. They're struggling to cope. They're being addressed. People's transitions are being addressed far too late. My inbox, as I'm sure all of your inboxes, are full of people saying, my son or my daughter leaves next week and we don't have a transitions plan in place. So we really need something that pulls all this together, that coordinates it, that works well with the different aspects on the salad or on the plate, but that is dedicated to saying we will have a national transition strategy that will look at what action we need to improve the outcomes of disabled young people, that we will have a plan that's in place for specifically that group of people that is specifically to address their transition, and that there will be responsibility at ministerial level and accountability to make sure that people and families can see clearly what their rights are. And I would contend that professionals working in the area also understands what that means too, so that they can navigate that salad a bit more easily.
Thanks, Kavira. But isn't the last thing we need another strategy? Isn't it action that we need? And on that basis, what this process has done of interrogating your bill has laid bare, I think, for all of the committee, the shocking situation that exists. And wouldn't the purpose that we're all committed to be better served by actually looking very closely at what doesn't work, not focus on one aspect of it, or a couple of aspects, as your bill does, and actually set about changing lots of little things that would make a huge difference? So isn't there a bigger picture here beyond the bill that we ought to be focusing on more?
Yes, absolutely. And I appreciate and I thank Graeme Day for saying that. There is a much bigger picture. And I hope that through bills that will come to Parliament, including the incorporation bill, at some point, a national care service, that all of these areas will be areas where we can start to look at what needs to change. Because you're right, so much needs to change. But fundamentally, what we haven't got in legislation at this minute in time is a right for children and young people to have a transitions plan from the age of 14 that follows them through to the age of 26 or beyond, and there's regulation making powers in the bill to do that, that really focuses on what they need in order to give them a fighting chance at a future. And that just isn't there just now. Because when you look at what implementation gap, of course, as Ruth Maguire highlighted, but when we look at the legislation, I'm not surprised there's an implementation gap, because the legislation is not directing and focused on this particular group of people. It's leaving professionals unclear about what it is their duties are, and it's not giving young disabled people that accountability so that they can hold people to account. One of the things I've learned, and I've learned a lot since coming to Parliament in May 21, I think this has probably been the steepest, fastest learning curve of my life. And one of the things I've learned is that there's nothing sharpens a minister's mind more than getting them on their feet and having to talk about something that they've done in Parliament and in the Chamber. And disabled people don't get that opportunity, because there's so much over the last decade, two decades even. Bill and I have worked together for a long time on issues like this. I won't embarrass him to suggest how long, but it's been a while. And we're constantly told this guidance will do it. This is the bit that will work. This strategy will work. Just focus on what doesn't work and change that little bit. Well, actually, I'm sorry to say, the bit that doesn't work is the bit that this bill is trying to address, which is to give people that right in statute to have a plan that gives them a fighting chance at the future.
Very brief point on the salad. Part 5 of the Children and Young People Scotland Act, which is where the child plan features, has never been commenced. So it isn't part of the salad. And the Scottish Government have announced it will be repealed. I'm still waiting for it to happen. But it's not part of the salad. There's no obligation on local authorities to do anything in regard to Part 5 at the moment. And then we have the coordinated support plans. And as we know, they're affecting a tiny minority of the disabled children and young people in the school system at the moment. So what this creates is one piece of legislation that creates a duty on local authorities to do it, and, if Scottish Government agree, will provide them with the resources to actually do the planning and to provide the support after the young people have left school. And it is important that it continues after they leave school. As I say, too many young people are being abandoned with no contact with them whatsoever. And so the worklessness rate and the economic inactivity rate, as Pam's already pointed out, is huge. And we cannot afford to lose that resource from our economy.
Okay, thank you.
At the moment. We need those young people to be entering work and entering training, getting the skills they need, etc.
Can I move to questions now from Stephen Kerr, please?
I think Co-Cabinet and I were going to ask a similar question about definitions. Why you've chosen to use the definitions that are deployed in the Equality Act 2010 as opposed to a broader definition? Because that has certainly had an impact in terms of the financial memorandum and the costs that Co-Cab will maybe comment on.
Vice Convener will drill down more on the finance questions later.
Can we start with the issue of the definitions and what your calculation of those definitions is in terms of the number of people that the bill will cover.
Yep, absolutely, and I thank Stephen Kerr for that question. The definition that we've chosen in this piece of legislation is the definition of disabled person in the Equality Act. And the reason we've chosen that is because I would contend that that is broad. And that does include people on the autistic spectrum, people with learning disabilities, people with mental ill health, because it is about how an impairment impacts on your social interaction and the way you interact with society. And if it has a long-term impact on it, then you're considered a disabled person. And actually, the Scottish Government's own guidance that they have around definitions of people who can get support at transitions, which I think is provided through a service called Inquire, includes this definition of disabled people. So actually, that, to be honest with you, that shows a little bit of inconsistency, because on one hand, the current legislation talks about people with additional support needs, but on the other, the government are giving out information that uses the definition in the Equality Act. Now, I think they're correct to do that, because it is about specifically addressing the needs of this group of people. The other groups of people that are included in statistics for and people with additional support needs include care leavers, include people who are young people who are gifted. And so that's why it's broader. Now, I'm not suggesting for a second that those children don't have additional support needs. They do. Or that they don't need support. They do. What I'm suggesting is that there is a cohort of people that are deliberately categorised as having a protected characteristic in the Equality Act, because it recognises the fundamental oppression and discrimination that they face, and that group of people is who this bill is for. And people worry that that means it doesn't include certain impairment categories. Actually, the Equality Act is drawn broadly for that specific purpose. And if we look back at the records on Hansard when the Equality Act was being developed, there was a lot of discussion in Parliament at the time about how you would define disabled people, and it looked very much at shifting the narrative from a medical model focus to a social model focus. And that's why I think the definition in the Equality Act of a disabled person is the right one for this piece of legislation.
But there's an element of self-identification in there as well, isn't there?
There is, but it's also about suggesting that it has a long-term impact on people's life. And actually, that's not new. I mean, this is how organisations and schools, I would say, education authorities, universities, colleges, are already identifying some of their disabled young people. And I know that it's also been suggested in some evidence that how will authorities identify young
yes.
disabled people? How
yeah.
will they come across them? How are they going to know
My
where they are?
My next question, yeah.
Excellent. I'm glad to be on the front foot for a change. So they are doing this. They are doing this, Stephen Kerr. And the reason I know they're doing this is because the data on young people with additional support needs is broken down by large numbers of categories of impairment. So they know who these young people and children and young people are. Also, I think to suggest that teachers, that schools don't know the pupils in their classes who need that extra support and who could be considered a disabled person is just not the case, I don't think. I think they have very good relationships.
But who ultimately decides? Because there will be some people who feel that they or their children should be included in those who will automatically receive this support in terms of a plan. And there will be other people who will say that they shouldn't. So who ultimately decides?
In essence, the same way as the Equality Act determines it, if you believe that you are impaired to a significant degree where it impacts on your daily life, you would claim, or you or the parents would claim that that child is entitled to the support and would have an Equality Act claim that they could do so if it was refused. But as Pam said, around 1,800 children are already identified among school leavers as disabled children and young people, and the ASN statistics can be broken down by impairment category. There's a lot of people under the ASN who would not qualify as disabled people because the level of impairment they have doesn't have a significant impact on their daily lives. To give you an example, and I'm not by any means saying that there is no impairment involved, but children with dyslexia, for example, they have approximately the same number of positive outcomes as children without dyslexia, right? So the level of impairment doesn't seem to have a significant impact on whether they go to college, higher education, or get employment. Whereas for children with learning difficulties or a motor impairment or a speech or language impairment, 10% of all those children fail to get a positive destination on leaving school, four times the rate for those without an impairment. So, you know, there is definitely something there, and I believe the Equality Act is good enough for Scottish Government, usually. It's good enough for the UK Government. Why is it not good enough, you know, for children and parents? It's the normal way of defining disability.
Can okay. I add to that, if that's okay, yeah. Stephen Kerr, just before you come back in? There, actually, schools and the structures around young disabled people now are probably contending with this exact question, because there's not a situation where... So, for example, everyone can see I'm a disabled person, so there's no hiding, not that I'd ever want to do that, actually. I'm proud of my identity. But if you can't see an impairment, there is always the question of how do we know you're a disabled person? Schools are already asking those questions, because they have to be, to identify the young people they're working with. And there are various different mechanisms that they can use to do that. You know, they can ask about what support people need. They can look at if there's a diagnosis in place. And, of course, that then gets us into waiting times, and that is a whole other question, and actually goes back to Graham Day's point about a number of problems that currently exist and how we're going to address them. That's something that ultimately will need to be looked at as well. So these questions are not new as a result of the definition we've used in this bill. The purpose of the definition in this bill is to give a focus specifically to those people who have that protected characteristic in recognition of the fact that they are significantly oppressed and discriminated against.
When COCAP comes on to talk about the financial implications of how this is defined, they are very significant. Mm-hmm. My last question really is about this. There's been a number of memorable phrases that have kind of stuck with me during the presentation of the evidence in relation to this bill. One, of course, is the salad that's been much mentioned earlier. There was that someone said, you can't legislate for a relationship. And what we know from the evidence that we've received, particularly from individuals that are impacted most, that's the young people and also their parents and carers, is that relationships are the critical element in all of this. So, for example, you mentioned in your opening statement Falkirk, where there was much mention of an individual whose whole job is based around supporting families and individuals through those transition journeys, right through, as you've mentioned, to the age of 25. And so that single point of contact becomes a critical relationship in the management of what you also described as the project. So should, when it comes to resources and the resources that will flow with this, basically, I suppose my question is, should every local authority have someone like the person that we heard about in Falkirk? And what are the implications of that in terms of resources and the direction of resources, which are already quite scarce?
Thank you again for that question. Technically, I'll come to the technical detail in the bill on it, which says that a lot of that actually can be down to sometimes regulation and guidance, so that local authorities can decide the model that suits best themselves. But what I will say about your point on legislating for relationships, you can't legislate for relationships, but you can legislate to put people in the room and build those relationships. And that's what this bill seeks to do. There is also, I know, much work, because I've been looking at the action plan that's been published by the Scottish Government on the coordinated support plans and also on the ASL review. And I know from the Minister Claire Haughey and Christina McKelvey's evidence a couple of weeks ago, or last week, that the National Transition Strategy may indeed begin to address some of these questions. That's all really, really valuable. And in fact, there's work ongoing about the creation of qualifications for teaching support and additional support teachers in schools. All of that will add to this. All of that will be really helpful and important. But none of it legislates to make sure people get in the room and somebody takes control of what's happening. And that's what I think the benefit of this bill will bring.
Thank you. Bob Dorris, you have a brief supplementary on this thread.
Just very briefly, because the thrust I want to come in is after the Vice Convener's line of questioning. Bill Scott, you'd helpfully mentioned about the broad definition under the Equalities Act, and you'd mentioned dyslexia, and I think you're making the point that there's more, all disabilities have impacts, but there's maybe more profound, complex mix of disabilities where there's a greater need, and dyslexia, without just being disparaging about it, may not necessarily be there. But specifically within the guidance of the Equalities Act, dyslexia specifically mentioned as being qualifying, because I'm just wrestling with when you're talking, Mr. Scott, about more profound disabilities and less... I'm paraphrasing, so I apologise, I'm not trying to put words in your mouth, but more profound disabilities or less profound disabilities, and you mentioned dyslexia as potentially being less impactful. But dyslexia is specifically a qualifying disability in terms of the Equalities Act, so I'm just wondering if you want to say a little bit more about that.
Mental health is also a qualifying disability in terms of the Equality Act. I myself have a mental health condition. I suffer periodic depression. There are times when I would define myself as a disabled person. I don't just now, because my mental health is good. And this is the difference. The Equality Act doesn't just say it's the condition that qualifies you as a disabled person. It has to have a significant impact on your daily life for a period of time, unless you're terminally ill, etc. So you have to move beyond has the person got an impairment to is that impairment having a significant impact on their daily lives? If the answer to that is yes, then they qualify for support under this bill.
If the person says, Mr. Scott, that I don't think I've progressed as smoothly within school as I would have done because of barriers in relation to dyslexia, as I think almost everyone with dyslexia would say is a matter of course, and they'd have a strong case in relation to that. Therefore, you could argue that everyone with dyslexia would qualify for this transitions plan. Would that be a reasonable assumption to make?
It would be a reasonable assumption if they could show that their progression had not advanced to the same extent. In other words, if their grades were high, etc., despite the fact that they say their progression wasn't good, then it doesn't appear to be impacting on their daily life. Of course they can make the case, and if that turns out to be the case that they're not progressing as well,
I found that was going around circles a little bit there in the response. But can I come to Stephanie Callaghan now for some questions? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for being here this morning, Pam. It's great that you've been highlighting this stuff. It really is fantastic. A couple of things you've said already as well that I thought were really quite powerful about your mum saying, now I can be a mum again. So important. And also you spoke about the legislative salad and said about none of it is actually delivering what it is that we need to see just now. So certainly that having guidance, having strategies, having duties is absolutely fine. But it does come down to those relationships, that advocacy, and people feeling they have agency as well. So we've heard from young people and families and the evidence as well that often professionals will identify positive destinations for them. So I suppose positive destinations in quotation marks there, but that those don't always reflect the kind of aspirations and the interests and the things that matter to young people and to their families too. And we've also heard about data and control about young people wanting to own their own story and, again, have that agency and control and have choices around sharing their data. What I'm really interested in, two quite specific things there. How will the bill bring an approach that's centred around the young person and their aspirations and, secondly, improve their outcomes? Thanks.
Thank you very much, Stephanie Callaghan, for that question. And I know that you've got a really keen interest in this and you're passionate about the rights of young disabled people. I thank you for the work that you've done on it so far. Those questions actually are key. And when you look at the detail in the legislation, which I know this committee has been doing, and I thank them for the work they've done on it, almost at every point, and I haven't seen another piece of legislation that really quite done this, and I've tried to have a look, every point that there's either a regulation duty or a duty on some other bodies, or there's a development of a strategy or a development of a plan, there's also almost the same clause that says, and must consult, and the young person and their family must be involved. So various different sections of the bill, Section 7, Section 11, Section 12, all cover areas of ensuring that this is a person-centred approach. Actually, this is what's most important about it. So when I said earlier about not wanting to be a project manager in your own life or the young person you love and care for's own life, it's not that you therefore want to devolve all responsibility and step aside. It's that you want to spend time thinking about Where do I want to go? Who do I want to be? What do I want to be? Do I want to end up in that particular destination? Is it positive? And actually, as an aside, I think there's a bigger conversation about how we define positive destinations for all young people in Scotland, not just for young disabled people. But those kind of questions need to be the focus, as opposed to has somebody contacted social work and let them know that in a couple of years' time this person might need self-directed support to be put in place? Does somebody has someone had a look at what kind of accommodation or housing is going to be available if that person goes to that college or university? Those are questions of those are transactional questions, managing a project as I described. They're not questions about where do I want to go when I grow up. Do I want to go to a college course? And I don't want to be disparaging, but I'm sure you have heard in evidence there are some situations where young disabled people, because of the aspirations that other people have, and we know there's plethora of data and research that shows that non-disabled people sometimes have lower expectations of disabled people than they themselves have. And then the statistic I said earlier on about people's aspirations actually almost kind of being beaten down. Because of that, people do end up kind of parked in certain courses that they might not want to be in. And I would contend that that might be because we're rushing at the last minute to find a destination of any description, positive or otherwise, to be honest. Because what I've heard from people when I've spoken to them about this legislation is that it's all decided far too late. So you're often faced with a situation where this young person is going to leave school maybe in a matter of weeks. What are we going to do? We'll have to do something. Right, this college course, they can definitely go and do that life skills course or otherwise. Now, those courses, and I, to put on record, I'm not suggesting that they're not appropriate for some people. They are, of course they are. But we shouldn't end up in a situation where we don't have much time, so we're panic placing almost people into situations that aren't really positive destinations, they're just destinations. And I think this bill, in bringing that planning process in a more streamlined fashion, starting at an earlier point and giving people responsibilities to get round the table and having somebody out with the family being the person that makes sure, have you done the bit you would do? Have you phoned the person you said you'd phone? Have you been in touch with this? That is so important because it then allows the family to focus on what the destination is.
So I really don't disagree with much of what you're saying. Mm. And yeah, I hear this stuff myself, absolutely. So I suppose for me, though, the part of it that really concerns me is, you know, when we're talking to practitioners, et cetera, as well, what we're hearing is that transition shouldn't be something quite separate. It should be something that's organic and built in all the way through. And I know North Lanarkshire Council have done loads of great work over the last 12 years. They've been absolutely fabulous and fantastic. But we've had those comments from practitioners saying, you know, legislation is legislation. It's about the quality that's underneath that. And we've heard them actually say that they're worried about the idea of, you know, this is another plan. Plans piling up in somebody's desk that becomes, you know, something to be completed, that it could actually be reductionist and that it could end up in a bit of a tick box exercise for them as well. So actually that some of the good practice that they're kind of doing just now and evolving, that actually the plan might get in the way of that. So my question is, would it not be better to really focus on that good practice that's happening just now rather than specifically in the bill, look at bringing that forward, really supporting it and actually bringing in legislation to support that and make sure it is happening if that actually turns out to be a need for it there?
Thank you for that question. I think the point that you've ended on there about bringing in legislation to support that and make it happen, I think that's key. And I think in my earlier answer to possibly Stephen Kerr or Graham Day, forgive me, I can't remember, around the principles into practice, I think there are opportunities there for us to say, this is working really well, this is not working. There's lots of things that we can do to try and improve the practice on the ground. Of course there is, but ultimately legislation drives policy and policy drives practice, or it should. That's how I think we all know it should. And that's why I believe that we need to look at this. And the points that you've just made about the practitioners saying this is just another plan in a pile and there'll just be lots of other plans and there's all a bit much there, can we not just focus on what needs done? All of the reviews of the ASL legislation that currently exists agree with that practitioner. They agree with that. They say that it's all, there's too much almost to an extent, that we need a one plan, one child focus. That's what this bill does.
Okay, thank you.
Are you okay? Is that you finished, Stephanie?
Yes.
Excellent. Can we move to questions now from Ross Greer, please?
Thanks, Convener. Pam, I'd like to pick up on just exactly what you said there at the end about legislation drives policy, policy drives practice. And at the core of what you're proposing is this premise that we need to mandate this kind of action if we want to see transformational change. I'm interested in the comparison between that, and I think you've both mentioned so far this morning the experience with coordinated support plans, which are not the same thing, but if we're looking at in the same space, they are something that they're the only kind of plan at the moment that has that statutory underpinning that should result in the kind of compulsion on relevant authorities to actually improve support for a young person. But that doesn't happen. It doesn't happen, Bill, as you pointed out, for the 99.5% of young people who don't have a coordinated support plan, but even for the 0.5% who do, we have plenty of examples where, despite the fact they've got it, and despite the fact that's the statutory plan that should give them that ability to pursue recourse if they don't get support, that doesn't happen. So I'd be interested in your thoughts on why that statutory approach hasn't worked for CSPs, and the follow-up to that then is why, if it hasn't worked for CSPs, this would provide a solution to that, or this would result in a different outcome. It would actually result in the kind of compulsion on authorities that you're looking for.
Thank you, Ross Greer. I appreciate that, and also to recognise the passion that you have for this, and in fact, indeed, that all members who we've heard from so far have, and I welcome the support and energy around it. The implementation gap that actually was one of the first questions that Ruth Maguire addressed is, of course, crucial. And there is lots of legislation that we can all point to that still needs to be implemented. I understand that. I'd see that. And I've seen it when it comes to disabled people for decades. And actually, the question of justice and access to justice for disabled people is a real serious concern. And I'll talk a bit in a minute about the ways in which I think this bill addresses some of that and is enforceable. But just to... I recognise the work that is ongoing to look at whether or not we need qualifications for additional support teachers, how we encourage good practice. There's the award system as well for schools that recognises the good practice in education, but also of young disabled people and the journey they've travelled. All of that is ongoing and should continue. And I don't think this bill stops any of that. What this bill does do, though, is... And I've seen it time and time again, particularly when it comes to disabled people, but the same is true for all different protected characteristics. If we leave this to accident and default, then we end up defaulting in a situation where society is still discriminating against and oppressing a large group of people, disabled people. We have to fix this by design. We can't leave it to accident anymore. And that design, I believe, is looking at the various different bits of legislation that exist. And Ross Greer pointed out himself the point about the coordinated support plan not being the same as this. It's not. It has a different purpose. It was developed for a different purpose. This is developed for a specific purpose, and it's about a transition. And I think if we can get that... So there's almost two things here. Is the current legislative framework right? I don't believe so. Neither does a number of organisations, including the Law Society and the Children and Young People's Commissioner. So we need to change that. That's what the bit that I'm trying to do with the legislation. But we always have to change practice because, as Graham Day pointed out, there's good practice in places, but there's also some pretty poor practice that we need to shine a light on and address. And I would contend that this sharpens the minds and sharpens the focus on that by putting it into legislation, being much clearer and having that one child, one plan approach.
I really appreciate that, and you don't need me to tell you that there's logical, absolute logical consistency in what you're saying, but the conclusion is still that this bit of legislation will result in better practice. My question is, given that coordinated support plans are the result of another bit of legislation, that there are statutory requirements there and they've not resulted in the change in practice that we want, and I accept absolutely what you're saying, they're not exactly the same thing as this, they're not transition plans, but the premise of my question remains there of why will legislation result in the kind of change in practice that we're all looking for here when it doesn't other bits of legislation in that space that were intended for exactly the same thing, not specifically on transitions, but were intended to force a change in practice, haven't forced that change? What's different here?
And I would suggest, and thank you for that further question, I would suggest that scrutiny is part of the problem here. And I probably go back to one of my earlier answers on having a minister and having the strategy laid in Parliament, having a reporting period so that people know there's going to be a point at which they can scrutinise the development of this. Right now, we don't have a strategy to address this. And I know that the government is bringing one forward, and I really welcome that. But I think we do need this in legislation because, you know, we can't just leave it in manifesto commitments that may or may not ever be enacted or that only exist whilst a certain good-intentioned, passionate member of the cabinet is driving it forward. We need to do this in legislation, and I think that's incredibly important. We also need an opportunity for people to be able to hold ministers to account for this, and that's what this bill specifically does. That doesn't exist in the other parts of in other pieces of legislation. And on specific parts, and if you forgive me, I'll look at my notes a wee bit more for this bit so that I get the sections right. Section 1 on the National Transition Strategy provides, I think, a clear reference point to local authorities and other agencies. It says that the aims and objectives and outcomes need to be set out. Those are important. Also, the actions that authorities will need to take. That ministers think will be necessary to improve transitions. Having that piece in having something like that in legislation cannot be underestimated. Section 4 says that local authorities and other agencies would have a statutory duty when exercising those functions to comply. So again, that's another point at which you would be able to scrutinise the way that these have been developed. Section 6 says that a member of government or minister would have assigned responsibility for this, and we've changed the language in this version of the bill from the previous version of the bill to take account of some concerns of previous committees. Section 9 says that local authority must ensure each disabled child or young people receives the care and support that to meet the needs in the plan. Section 14 says Scottish ministers might introduce guidance about transitions and local authorities and agencies, and that they must have regard to it. Section 15 says they should issue general or specific directions about plans. And Section 16 requires ministers to lay before Parliament an annual report on progress. All of these things don't exist yet. And I think they would add the scrutiny that young disabled people and their families really need to be able to go to. Because people can come to me, and all of us indeed as parliamentarians just now, and say, I'm tearing my hair out. We've all heard it. I'm tearing my hair out. My young person's leaving school next week and nothing's in place. This morning I've heard exactly that story where somebody with significant support needs is now stuck at home. They've already left school and nothing's is yet in place, and they don't have an adult social worker in place. We know that this... So they come to us and we say, right, we'll put pressure on, and we do what we can. We write letters, we have meetings, we call people. But actually, when we go back to say, well, what are the duties and responsibilities that people have here? And they're not clear, and they're not as robust, I think, as this bill is. And that's why we need to change that.
That's great. Thank you very much.
Can I come to some supplementaries on this theme from Willie Rennie first, please?
I think Ross's question is really quite a powerful question. And I think you've gone some way to deal with it. There's a slight counsel of despair that because we've not been able to enforce it before, we shouldn't ever try to do it again in terms of statutory nature around about plans. But nevertheless, it does beg the question, is this going to be any different from before? And it is open to us to scrutinise coordinated support plans. You know, we can question them in Parliament. We can do all that stuff just now. So there's nothing stopping us doing it. But you're saying by stipulating that a minister's responsible and there is scrutiny angles, that will somehow change it. I mean, is there any parallels in other areas where that's really made a difference? Yeah, Bill?
Yeah. Yes, there is. About 7 years ago, the HRC published a study that it conducted into modern apprenticeships in Scotland. Maybe some members will remember it. It identified that 0.5% of modern apprenticeships were going to young disabled people when they made up between 8 and 9% of the young people in Scotland. Nowadays, if you ask Skill Development Scotland how many are modern apprenticeships are going to young disabled people, it's exactly the same proportion as there are young disabled people in Scotland. And that was because of parliamentary scrutiny. That was because Parliament decided that was an important issue and put their weight behind it. And what we are saying is we're creating a right for young disabled people to have a plan. And the actual, you know, the Scottish Transitions Forum, which you've heard evidence from, says planning should start early and continue until age 25 for all young learning disabled people. Is there any legal duty for that to happen at the moment? No, there is not. It does not exist in the child's plan, and it does not exist in the coordinated support plan. Both of them are for education. They stop after the child's left school. This is the only plan that actually guarantees support after the young person's left school. And that is why it's important, because we're failing them after they leave school as well as failing them at school.
Thank you.
So that's why the plan is needed, and that's why legislation is needed to change things.
That's right. Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks for allowing me back in, Convener. And I really appreciate that. I think that's a really important point that you've made there, Bill, about that scrutiny, really making a change in that area there. But I am coming back to the point, you know, that's been made by Ross around practice. Yep. So it's still, for example, we heard about a wee boy who wanted to be a pilot. They take him along to the airport and he's as interested in the baggage as anything else and ends up with a job in the baggage department. So really, it's about this particular legislation. Is this bill really going to be the thing that changes practice? Would that make that happen for other wee boys? Would they be in a similar situation where it changes things for them in that way? I think that's the nitty-gritty of this.
And that's the question that I'm trying to answer with the bill. And I guess what I would point to is what Bill's just said in relation to modern apprentices. And also just to add to the answer to Willie Rennie's question, which I thank him for, is to say that right now we could, of course, say this coordinated support plan wasn't put in place, or actually we'd be more likely to say there was no coordinated support plan, given the statistics. But we're still dealing with, it's like one person, one person, one person in an isolated situation. So that's kind of constantly firefighting. There is nothing that pulls all of that together. I think this bill does two things in that sense. I think it puts on a statutory footing, and I've already made comment about the purpose and need to do that, the need for a national strategy that looks at how are we going to address these issues, and it gives individual rights. So it does both of those things at the same time. One of the things that disabled people get told so often, and part of this is because I think nobody really wants to be associated with not doing what is right for disabled people. Most people set out every day when they work in this field and do the right thing and do as much as they possibly can. But we're constantly told that circumstance of bad, that was a one-off, or that only happened in this situation. It doesn't happen in all situations. We really need to have a broader focus on that as well, which I think the strategy part of this legislation suggests. And then just to finish on your final question, which was there. I'm sorry, I'm not suggesting this is your final question. I'm not chair of the committee.
I'm chair of the committee, and I'm wanting to move to Michael Mara very quickly, if you don't mind.
Excellent, I will do.
Ms. Duncan Clancy.
On that final point, the areas that I outlined in terms of scrutiny, so the ministerial assignment of ministerial responsibility, the laying before Parliament, the annual report, the review of plans, the review of the strategy, all of these things sharpen the focus to make sure that if we're doing the right thing on the ground, we know we are because we're asking.
Thank you. Michael Mara, please.
Thanks, Convener. Pam, you'll have watched the evidence given to us by ministers last week, and I think the thrust of that for me was we've got a strategy coming. So do you think we should wait, see what's in it, it's published, and see whether it works?
Thank you, Michael Mara, for that question. No, I don't. I said earlier on in my opening statement that the data that the committee are aware of, the young disabled people are 3 times more likely to not end up in education, employment or training. That data was the same in 2008 when Inclusion Scotland wrote the briefing that I've got in front of me today. It probably was the same previously to that too. We are consistently, disabled people are consistently told this next strategy will be the thing. You don't need this in legislation. I remember this from working in policy when I worked in this area. It is constantly the next thing will do it, the next thing will do it, and it hasn't done it yet. And here we are, almost 20 years since we've been starting working together in this field. Sorry, Bill, I did say I wouldn't out that number. And we still don't have the rights of young disabled people delivering the fighting chance that they need. So no, I'm afraid I would say I don't think we should wait. I guess I would ask the committee, how long do they think disabled people should wait? When do they think is the right timescale to say this is or is not working? Because there are disabled people out in communities right now who are either about to leave school or have already left school with no plan. And they can't wait to see if the government's strategy, which isn't yet published, and I acknowledge fully that, that they've committed to it, and that it's and I fully believe it will be published, and I believe they, I take the ministers for their word, but they can't wait for this. And so I would urge the committee to really, really question that, look at that question and say, how long do you think it's acceptable to wait to see whether that strategy works?
I think there's huge frustration, and I can hear that from both yourself and Bill Scott, and I think around actually the committee in terms of the delivery and the, what is going to make this happen. I suppose that's probably come to the kind of the nub of the discussion today, really. I mean, I had a meeting with a chief executive council earlier this week, who said they're now in a position where they can do nothing that is not required of them by law. I mean, is that the situation that disabled people are facing?
Absolutely, that is the situation that disabled people are facing. And if you'll forgive me, I'm just looking back to see, I've got a quote here, I think, from Audit Scotland, yes, that speaks to that. So they've said in a blog on transitions, it's distressing and frustrating that we repeatedly hear of the barriers that some families fight against to get the right support to help their child to learn. Too often families are worn down by a prolonged search for the right support and by having to manage a crisis that could have and should have been avoided. And they then go on to note, councils provide support in different ways with a wide variation in spending. This partly reflects the different ways services are provided and the varying costs of supporting individuals, but, crucially, may also reflect local decisions by councils to prioritise between a wide range of services. So Audit Scotland themselves recognise that councils are in, and I should put on record, councils are in a horrific position right now, and I don't, and I in no way underestimate that. And I don't think now is the place to get into the point on the budgets. But because I could be here for another 3 hours, I think, if we touched on that. But you really hit the nail on the head there, Michael Mara, when you make the point about them really struggling to do just the statutory responsibilities. And I cannot tell you how often disabled people face the argument that it's not an obligation, so we don't have to do it. Social care is an example. Eligibility criteria get stripped back and stripped back and stripped back till we are literally doing the only thing that we have to do, which is keep you alive. And that's what we are trying to avoid with this bill for transitions and young disabled people.
Bill Scott, do you want to come in on this?
Yeah, again, it's how do you measure success? So suppose there is a strategy developed and published, and I believe ministers, and I've worked with those ministers, I understand fully they are committed to trying to deliver on that strategy. How do you measure success? Well, one of the ways might be, for example, how many young disabled people are benefiting from the Young Persons Guarantee? Can Scottish ministers tell us how many young disabled people are benefiting from the Young Persons Guarantee? No, they can't, because they don't collect any statistics on whether young disabled people are accessing the guarantee or not. And we're in the same position as with modern apprenticeships. We don't know, and therefore we don't care, and we don't act. So the statistics that we are presenting to you should tell you we're failing young disabled people at the moment. We need to act, and it has to go beyond guidance, because at the moment local authorities are absolutely so hard-pressed that they will only do what they are required to do in law. This requires them to do something in law. It'll have to happen, and it carries a budget with it. And I know we're going to come on here.
Thanks, Camille.
Thank you very much. Well, that's a nice segue in to the next line of questioning from my vice convener, Cocab Stewart, please.
Thank you, convener. We'll just have a look at the financial memorandum, and I think, Bill, you've already sort of alluded to the fact that you maybe have got the figures wrong.
I've got them wrong. I said I'm prepared to listen to arguments that I've got them wrong.
Right.
I think your words were, we might have got figures wrong, yeah. As what okay. You said. Thank you.
Thank you for the clarification, convener. So the approximate cost you've got down in your financial memorandum was £893,372 in year one. But the COSLA estimate is actually 11 times that. So can I get a wee bit of an understanding of how you originally came across your figures?
To see how COSLA came across their figures, because they don't provide any figures accompanying that estimated 10
okay,
million.
OK, but can I get an understanding of how you came across your figures, how they were informed?
We used the figures that COSLA supplied on the gradings that, of the people that would be likely to be assigned this work, and then worked out the number of hours that, and again, based on how many hours were normally done on similar work by local authorities in assisting people through transitions. So the hours and the grading are those supplied by COSLA, and then we worked out the number of young people that would require a plan to be put in place and multiplied it by the number of hours and the number of people and the grade.
OK, so we've talked a little bit about the definitions of disability that would be included under the Equalities Act. We've also taken evidence from in other sessions about the underestimation of time that's allocated to prepare because of the complexity of arranging and delivering multi-agency meetings. So on reflection, do you feel that your figures are an underestimate?
There could be an underestimate. And you know, I think the true figure probably lies somewhere between what we've estimated and North Lanarkshire's estimate. And North Lanarkshire would estimate about three times the cost. But I have to say that what they're looking at is the transition from children's to adult social care. And that can be that, those transitions are particularly complex because the young people that go through that transition need a lot of support. The great majority of the young disabled people that would be covered by the transitions plan in this bill are not receiving social care, and therefore that's not part of their transition. So the average that we've arrived at is one for a lot of young disabled people who do not have complex needs but do have needs based on their impairment. So the average lies somewhere between those at the high end and those at the very low end. So, you know, as I say, I think we probably are somewhere between North Lanarkshire's estimate and our own. Say it's another £5 million on top of the £10 million that we estimate after year eight. I still think that's money well spent. And I don't think we should be quibbling about a few million here or there. I know every pound is precious, but these are young people's lives we're talking about, and we're talking about for the rest of their lives, that investment at that early stage. And this, I agree with previous children's commissioners and the previous poverty advisor at the Scottish Government, there are key points in people's lives where an intervention by the state can make a real difference. And that's what we're asking for.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm just concerned more about the figures rather than the principle. Yeah. I don't disagree with what you're saying there. Pam?
Thank you, Co-Cab Stewart. I appreciate that, and thank you for your question. I think to say at the outset, we've done the best that we can to produce the figures that you have in front of you in the financial memorandum. But as is the case with the bill itself, we're prepared to discuss these in detail. I have had meetings with COSLA. There are points of departure where they say that this would be... they would need an additional member of staff to do something where I've said, well, actually, your existing staff have duties and responsibilities to do this. So there are a few questions about what is an existing responsibility and a cost attached to it. And I would argue that if we're not already putting in the resources that COSLA say we need to in order to meet the requirements of disabled people to have a fighting chance at a future, then I would say we're failing them. And so actually, I would say that that's an admission of failure in that respect. But when it comes down to the pounds and pence and the figures, let me start with the 4,000 people that we've said in the financial memorandum. That figure's been taken on the definition used in the census for disabled people that would be able to access a plan under this particular piece of legislation, looking at what the number of ASN pupils are, as well as the census data. And it came to 4,000. Now, the census data uses the definition in the Equality Act, usually of disabled people. And that has then been, what we've then done is look at that, multiplied it by the number of local authorities. And of course, the law of averages suggests that, and we've seen evidence, I know you've taken evidence, written evidence, I believe, from councils like Glasgow who've said it will be much more, and other authorities who've said it will be different. And I understand that that could happen in concerns of in the way that you use averages. The most important thing here, I think, to remember is this. If we're already, say, if the argument of COSLA and of local authorities is that it will be significantly more expensive to do this, then we have to ask ourselves, what are we not doing already? That there is such an additional... Because we've spent a lot of time this morning talking about existing duties, existing responsibilities and existing legislation. But we've also got a situation where organisations like COSLA are saying, well, actually, it will cost a lot more if we have to do this. So either they exist now and they should be spending it, or they don't exist, and that's another argument for the bill.
Right, OK. So the evidence received from the Finance and Public Administration Committee considered that the financial memorandum was understates the cost of implementing the changes, and you've just alluded to that. So what was your rationale behind the expectation that some of the costs would be accommodated within existing resources?
Because we know that young people in schools have access to pastoral care teachers, guidance teachers, they were called in my day, and that they have existing structures that are in place that are there to support them. So, for example, Skills Development Scotland staff that engage with schools, either special schools or state schools. So there are existing structures that are there, and arguably those existing structures should be treating all young people equally, and that includes young disabled people. But the statistics show that they're not yet. So what we're saying is there is a mechanism here in this bill to try and address some of that, to focus attention on it. I'd like to provide reassurance to the committee that I'm in no way ears closed, eyes closed to a different perspective on the finance. But what I will say is, and I say that also on the basis that I go back to my comment earlier about the cost for local authorities, the last thing anybody wants to do is land local authorities with duties that they don't have the financial support to back up. Now, we have to do that. That, I would contend, is the government's responsibility. What I think we have to do just now, though, is remember two comments, one by the National Audit Office that said that good support, And I would contend that good transitions would be that, can save £1 million per person. £1 million per person. So even if we take our estimate and COSLA's estimate and we take the £5 million extra, that's five people. We only have to get this right for five people and there'll be a longer term saving to the state. And secondly, comments by the Law Society, who said that the wider costs of inaction would be greater in comparison to the costs of implementation. And it is the context of those two statements that I approach the question of the financial resolution.
Can I ask something specifically? You mentioned, Pam Duncan Clancy, about you used the definition and the numbers from the census, OK? Given that the last census that we have, that I can find anywhere, is 2011, and we know that there was significant issues around the census that were carried out last year, that's quite some time ago, that data you're using, and I would just challenge that it might be perceived to be out of date.
And that's a fair contention, convener. It was the most up-to-date census data that was available to us when we prepared the financial memorandum, but it's also not unreasonable to assume that that's the case because, as I referred to earlier, we cross-referred it with the data on children with additional support needs. So when you look at those data, which are actually updated a bit more regularly, including yesterday, I believe, then when you look at that and then you look at the number of disabled people in the census, you can come to a conclusion about the number of people who would access support under this plan.
Go back to the Vice-Convener, please.
Thank you, Convener. So at last week's meeting, you were aware that the Minister for Children and Young People said that ministers had discussions with you about the modelling on the financial memorandum, and that you were looking to work with stakeholders to better understand the potential costs of the bill. And you've said that you haven't yet met with COSLA. Can you give us an update of which stakeholders you have engaged with or are intending on engaging with?
Sorry, I think I said, and thank you, Co-Cab Stewart, for that. I think I said I had met with COSLA.
Not
that
I hadn't.
I have met with COSLA twice, I believe, now. I've met with a range of stakeholders. I've done engagement all across Scotland on this bill. Members will have possibly seen the bit of a roadshow that I did during the summer period, and that engaged people who work in the field, people who work in the DWP, people who work in Skills Development Scotland. I've also specifically met them separately to that engagement. I met with teachers on those roadshows. I met with young disabled people. I met with their family and their carers. So the extensive engagement that's been carried out on, I have met with probably most of the stakeholders that I think you would consider need to be engaged in this particular process. But I'm willing to meet with anyone who believe they have a stake in this to discuss with them how best to make it work. Because, and again, I hope this has come across to the committee, I want to make this work. I want to do the right thing. I want to be able to ensure that things like the financial memorandum are accurate, and we've done that to the best that we can. Bill acknowledged that if there are other numbers and then we'd be prepared to discuss that. We did spend a lot of time coming to the conclusions that we did, and our rationale is there. And I also that is the way in which I approach stakeholder engagement on it too. So if people want to talk with us, I'd be more than happy to. But I have already engaged a large number of groups, including the Transitions Forum as well.
Bill, did you want to come in there?
Yeah, it's very quickly, both on Finance and Audit Committee and the COSLA estimates. There is one thing wrong with their assumptions, I have to say, and that is that they assume that every young disabled person with a plan will still be accessing support 12 years after, 8 years, 10 years after they leave school. We don't think that that will be the case. Almost half of them have positive destinations, which they actually manage to maintain. We don't think that they will be accessing support. There will also be attrition, which every service provider knows about, that if you're calling people in for meetings and they don't believe there's any purpose to them, they'll drop away and they will cease accessing support. You also lose contact with people. So some of the estimates that they've made are false, we think, because they don't take attrition into account and they don't take success into account. And we actually think that just providing the support in place will increase the number of successes, so there will be less people accessing support later.
We did hear about that dipping in and out would be quite important to young people in the transition and engaging at various times. I've got a very short supplementary from Graham Dee.
Thank you, Kabira. With respect, we shouldn't be sitting today disputing whether the figures are out by a factor of 3 or a factor of 11. But can I just go back to something to be clear on? I'm pretty sure in evidence we took last week, the ministers indicated that following a meeting they had with you late last year, an undertaking was given to go and talk to COSLA specifically on this issue and get the answers. If that's accepted, has that taken place, that meeting for that purpose? Because it sounds to me like it hasn't, because we don't have a kind of agreement on this today, on the numbers.
So there's no mechanism for us to replace the financial memorandum once it was laid, but we have met with COSLA and we did meet them to talk about the financial memorandum.
Thank you.
Convener.
The outcome of that was what Bill's described, which is there is a departure in our agreement on the figures. But I would like to assure Graham Day that I honestly go back to my comments about the National Audit Office and the Law Society.
Thank you. I was going to say, if there is that departure, perhaps you can share that with the committee. I'm going to stop and move on to questions from Bob Dorris, because I've got my eye on the clock, Panda Clancy.
Thanks, Convener, and thanks yourself, Pam, and for the support Bill Scott's played in bringing this bill forward, and I acknowledge Joanne Lamont sitting following proceedings. Also, sometimes when there's goodwill with a bill, we still have to scrutinise it pretty robustly, so please take questions in that light. So, in relation to the financial memorandum, which the line of questions have been on, I see from my briefing here that it suggests that each meeting in relation to planning for transitions will require an average of 1 hour of preparation, 1 hour of follow-up. The meeting itself will take around 2 hours, and there's between 2 to 4 meetings each year. I know Andy Miller from SCLD disputed that as being realistic and doesn't take any cognizance of the complexities that could be involved. On reflection, do you think that's maybe a bit ambitious?
I think in a number of cases that will be accurate, but I acknowledge SLD's evidence and I saw their evidence. The way in which this has been approached and the hours and the way that we've calculated the sort of support that people will need on this is based on decades of work with disabled people, their organisations, their parents and organisations like, including SLD and others, to come to the best possible conclusion we can about it. Now, these things are always open to discussion. That's the purpose of parliamentary scrutiny. And it's really important that it's scrutinised like this. And to your point, your earlier point, Bob Doris, and I thank you for your question, that I would expect nothing less than significant scrutiny from the committee, because this is legislation. And this will be, I hope, at some point, on the statutes. And if we put something on the statutes, we need to be absolutely sure of that. And I've learned that a lot since coming to this place. So I expect the scrutiny, and I have prepared as best I can for your... I think the convener said earlier on, interrogation. Somebody said to me earlier, it won't be an interrogation, it'll be scrutiny. But either way, I'm here to answer your questions. And I will undertake to come back to the committee with further detail, particularly on the differences between causeless estimations and ours.
Pam, thank you. The only interrogation is likely to be is the convener moving me on if I ask too much time and questions.
No, you're OK at the moment, Mr Doris. I've got a new approach today.
Keep it moving. I acknowledge an answer. I'll weigh that up when we look at the evidence. I also see that in relation to the financial memorandum, in relation to the costs associated with much of that work when at school, those costs are assumed to be no additional resource required. And if I read from the briefing I have here, whilst the child remains at school, the cost of the guidance teachers or other members of school pastoral care staff time would fall within existing resources on the basis that the local authority officer will already have existing pastoral duties for and responsibilities for the child. I suspect some teaching and wider other colleagues would think they're pretty burdened with work just now without all this additional work. Any reflections on those comments?
I think that Bob Doris speaks to a very real and live concern, and you know, it doesn't escape me that this morning we're meeting as teachers are striking, and I think that it is fair to notice that more is being asked of teachers, more is being asked of additional support needs assistants in schools, and in fact there are fewer of them than there used to be, and that is part of the problem, I think. And you know, I guess I would go back to my earlier comment, Bob Doris, which is, this is not, it is absolutely not my intention to put something in place that burdens people with something that they do not have the resources or capacity to deal with. Part of the problem with the implementation gap that Ruth Maguire started this morning's session on is exactly that. I would argue also that one of the reasons teachers are striking today is because of the additional stress that they have in supporting young people in their classes just now. And that's all young people, including young disabled people.
I suspect if we debate that further, there'll be a bit of mission drift. I should acknowledge that I'm currently still an EIS member. Pam Duncan, Clancy, Mr Scott, are you coming in?
Can I just say, it will only really be the initial work and the planning that's going to take a lot of time at school, because the plan doesn't really take effect until the young person leaves school. So the plan's in place at 14. The meetings thereafter will really be, is everything still going to plan? Are we still on course? Have your needs changed? It's a check-in. It's not going to be formulating a new plan every time for the young person. And that, again, is why the average time is significantly less, and the cost, we believe, will be less while the children are still at school. They will rise when the child leaves school.
Okay. I want to drill down a little bit more numbers. Scott Richardson Reid from ARC Scotland was talking about what he thought the numbers in the system within the school estate could look like in relation to requiring transition plans. And look, in 2019, there were 128,000 young people capable of leaving school between S4 and S6. 47,500 did. I think Scott was estimating that he thought about 20% of young people who were leaving school were likely to have some form of additional support need, potentially qualifying for a transition plan, but that 37%, so that's 20% known to service, known to education, but it could be as high as 37% who'd actually potentially require a plan. Those numbers are dramatically higher than in the financial memorandum, and there's quite a significant disparity there. Any comments in relation to that?
Did you want to?
Well, right, yep. On this, if you look at the figures, and they were published yesterday, I can supply them to the committee later. Every young person who has additional support for learning needs has to have what those needs are identified. And of those, only less than 1,800 are identified as disabled people, young disabled people. We think that's an under-recording. Additional support for learning, if you look at it, if you look at the figures in detail, you will see that the outcomes for a whole number of those with additional support needs are no different, or even in some cases better, than the average for students, pupils with no additional support needs. And we don't think that a lot, and for example, the largest group in additional support needs, 6,000 with emotional and behavioural problems, aren't young disabled people. That was 6,000 school leavers for last year. So there's another 1,500 whose learning was interrupted. There's another 400 odd who are especially gifted. There's a lot in it under additional support needs that do not qualify as young disabled people. And there is a disparity between the 1,800 and I would say from eliminating a lot of the groups that are classed under ESN, probably around 7,000, who possibly, potentially, are impaired. But to the extent they're impaired, again, we would have to look at. But the best figures we had were the census figures. The census figures identify around 4,000 young people per year who are school leavers will have impairments at a level that they would qualify for protection under the Equality Act. That's the ones that we're aiming the transitions plans at. If there's a significant number of young disabled people more than that, then the census has failed to catch them, and so in many ways are a lot of other services failing to provide for them.
Mr. Dawes, finally from yourself here.
So I think rather, it's not about arguing about the financial memorandum. That's not the purpose of this. What the purpose of this is, without resource to the local authorities and other partner organisations, well-intentioned legislation, and that's not a glib comment, properly well-intentioned, thought-out legislation, will not drive a difference, and there will be a prioritisation of needs, just as they are currently in relation to ASM, where only 1 to 2% of young people to qualify for coordinated support plans actually get it. So there's a concern that if this passes, only the most complex disabilities, if you like, that young people have will be on the radar for local authorities and schools and others to provide a transition plan, and we'll end up with a very similar picture to coordinated support plans of maybe 1 or 2% of those that might otherwise qualify. Do you think that's a reasonable concern to have?
Briefly, if you don't mind, because I've got one more other question coming in.
No problem at all. Thank you, Bob Dawes. No, I don't. I think the opposite will be the case.
That's brief. Yes, lovely. Thank you. Can we move to a supplementary, please, from Michael Mara? Thanks.
So the government is preparing this strategy we've talked about, and there clearly will be costs associated with delivering that strategy to transform outcomes in transitions. Did, in your meetings with ministers, did they outline what they thought their costs were going to be that could be comparable to your own?
So that's a really interesting point. And actually, to try and get that information, I've had to submit a question, because the current budget, Level 4, doesn't detail specific funding for this. So it's difficult for me to tell what's already being spent on the transitions of young disabled people and how much the strategy will have behind it. And so that's the kind of question that I think that is really, really important, because some of the things that we focused on just now about the cost of this, that the bill, the cost associated with this bill must be specifically associated with the framework that it's putting in place to do it. And we specifically detail quite a lot of that in the financial memorandum in a way that I haven't necessarily seen some government budgets look, because it goes into significant level of detail. And we've all, in various committees, just scrutinised the budget. And I think it's fair to say it's been a difficult process. I'd contend that our financial memorandum, whether we consider the numbers of, because it's contingent on how many people and therefore how many hours, therefore the cost, we've detailed our rationale in a way that some government bills hasn't.
I'm going to reach out to Mr. Dawes, who may have something to ask.
I promise you, it's not just an add-on to the last line of questioning. It was inspired by Mr. Scott, who at the start of the evidence session was talking about there might not be ongoing costs because some young people may move on to positive destinations and further or higher education. But you'd also said elsewhere in the evidence session that we sign folk off saying they've reached positive destinations and further and higher education, but then we don't monitor to find out if they're real or not. So I'm not trying to catch out, but we kind of can't have it both ways. There's either ongoing monitoring to see if those positive destinations are realised for the period of time where the statutory obligations exist, or we don't. So I'm generally a little bit confused about that.
And you've got a couple, not long to answer that one, Mr. Scott.
If the right exists that you can re-enter the system at any point until you're 26, then you can re-enter the system, whether you were initially written off as having a positive destination or not. You can ask, I want to meet with the person responsible for my plan, and the person that helped me put together the plan, or the person designated by the local authority is responsible for the plan being implemented. I want to see them now, because the initial positive destination didn't turn out to be positive at all. So they can re-enter the system. I'm not denying that some people will re-enter the system, but what I'm saying is a lot of people who do enter employment, who do go in on higher education, get degrees, etc., won't access support.
Does that mean every young person would have a named person within social work?
I wouldn't use the word named person.
No, let's not use that. Mr. Doris?
That's got particular connotations, but a key worker, whatever you'll give it another designation. But
I'm relaxed with the named person, but there we are.
Yeah.
Thank you for that evidence, and I would like to thank you all for your time today. That's the public part of today's meeting at an end, and we'll consider our final agenda item in private. Thank you very much, and good morning.